First, I'd like to ask your permission to use this video for educational purpose and on the internet.
Yes, you have my permission.
We are 11 months after that scoliosis correction that we did. Tell me about your symptoms before first.
Well, I've had symptoms off and on for like 12 years, and sometimes they would subside and I had to be very careful. However, 2 years before, well, actually a year before I had the surgery, my back just gave out completely, and I was miserable. I probably didn't admit it to too many people, and I still tried to do my walk, and honestly, there were times when I went on a walk, I didn't know that I would make it back home without having to call somebody to come and get me. A lot of pain, a lot of nerve impingement, especially on my right side, radiating all the way down to my knee at times, and I just lived with it. And then in the summer of 2019, it just went out and there was nothing that I could do. So that's when I came to see you, and we tried one injection and it didn't even last probably 60 days. And I came back just expecting to get another injection. And instead we did talk about surgery. Unfortunately, COVID hit, so I couldn't have the surgery as soon as I wanted it, but I did have it last June.
So we are about 11 months out.
Correct.
No, you had back pain and the leg pain, correct?
Correct.
How 1 to 10, how bad was the leg pain?
Oh, it could be up to 10. The whole 10 at times.
How is it now?
I have no pain.
No pain, not in the back, not in the leg?
No.
Okay, when did the leg pain go away? Usually my patients say the back pain after surgery still linger and it goes slowly away.
Though I don't believe that I had leg pain at all.
After the surgery?
After the surgery, yeah. I did not. And the back pain, I did have back pain, but you know how it is? Once it's gone, you forget that you ever had it.
That's a good thing.
And so I will tell you that I did a lot of physical therapy. And I did virtual physical therapy because of COVID. And then I did face-to-face therapy. So I probably did therapy 6 months in a row.
Which is a routine. We send the patient always to physical therapy because the earlier you start that and more build up muscle in the spine, faster you can recover and be a full person again. And contrary to open old-fashioned surgery where we fillet, you open, all muscle die, in our surgery, which we did all of, you keep all those muscles. There's something to work with for physical therapist.
It is, and I worked up, I mean, I wasn't, I couldn't even bridge to begin with, and that was one of the areas that we kept working on. But I kept a journal at home, and I could tell from the journal when I was getting disappointed, thinking I wasn't making progress. But if I go back the month before, it was amazing how much progress I made with exercises. But I probably did 2 hours of exercises a day in the morning and at night. And it was just really mild strengthening until I could actually do some strengthening. And then both therapists that I worked with, it was just taking my base where I had made it to, and then making me stronger yet again. And I still do.
Healing is a process, and you should continue doing that, because muscles are like anything else in our body, use it or lose it.
I still do exercises. I have my routine down, and I do them in the morning because I tend at night, I'm just tired, and I find I don't do them as well if I wait. So I do them right away in the morning, but I have my core exercises down, and then I walk 3 miles a day.
Now, when you came here, I told you I have a good news and a bad news for you.
Yes, you did.
So let's start with the good news, okay? The good news is the bone is beautifully growing. All the holes where the nerves are going out are open, and there's no sign of trouble there. And here is where the screws are, and I'm going up and down, and it seems that the screws are all in the right position. Bone is growing in the front and here as well in the back, what we call the facet. So in the area we did the surgery, actually I'm very happy. And practically there's no scoliosis here in the area we did the surgery. You had a little scoliosis above where we did the surgery, even that is corrected. So that's the good news. For that area, you're a Wonder Woman. You have metal bone growing in a chunk. Now, what did I tell you about the bad news?
Well, the bad news, and you had mentioned it prior to the surgery, that there is a little areas up above where you did the surgery and right below where you did the surgery. So you were asking me, do I modify my activities so that that doesn't get worse?
Yeah.
Because you said you can't make me younger.
So yeah, the bad news is I cannot make you younger. Yeah.
And so I do modify. I just had mentioned I dug out some dandelions.
But yeah, you dug out some trenches.
I did, but I don't get down on my knees and do that. Instead, I had my son put my favorite tool, and he put it on a big long handle.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'm not bending over so much in doing
not
that.
Not so much. That's
so
good.
That's,
like, you love gardening?
I do.
Do raised garden, which has less demand to your spine. Or if people like golfing, they can do literally golfing without those heavy twisting, or learn the right technique to do that. These are all tricks we can use to live with the body we have, not with the body we wish we had.
And give up some things too. I mean, I just had said to you that I have a lot of gardens around the house, and I had just talked to my oldest son. It's like, we need to tear some of those out and just be done with it. And when I say we, he knows I mean him. and he knows that, because it's like, I can't do that type of, I can't keep that all up. And I'm okay with that.
Now, every surgery has a goal. And the goal of most of the surgeries that I do is making you an age-appropriate person, meaning that somebody giving you the activities that are expected as somebody your age group. Like, literally, I had a patient, and I still have that patient, very good patient, very reasonable, but her life is all about the marathon at 73 years old. If that's the goal, to make her run marathon at 73, I might not be able to achieve that goal for her. As well, if the goal is, you know, to live in a, to make your body a 30, 40-year-old body, that with those abilities of that kind of body, that is a goal that I probably will not be able to achieve. But realistically, what we can do like you are doing now those exercises every year, so you will have a better outcome that if you never had met me before, because now we send you through those physical therapy sessions. Now you're doing those exercises. You understand the value of them. You will get better mileage, but still our body is like a machine. It will wear down. Unfortunately, there is, as my father used to say, there is only one way not to get old, is to die young.
Is to die young. And it's interesting you'd bring up marathon. I used to be a runner, and I had a left knee replacement done. So prior to that, I stopped running, and it is something that kind of messes with your mental stress and emotional stress, because it's something you love to do. But
do you know why you people love to run?
The endorphins make you feel great.
Addictive. Yes.
It is
like,
is
addictive. Cocaine. It's
it
like,
is, and you go out every day.
Yeah.
But I had read an article from a former runner who was plagued with a lot of injuries, and they had taken up power walking, and I thought, and I thought I'm going to try that, because the premise was, if you power walk, you can get just as much benefit, and I really, really
did. And it's not those heavy impacts are very destructive, not only to spine, but to all your joint.
It was, and I still am facing probably another knee replacement, and he was aware my back was not good. And so he said, well, if you want to wear everything out after 2 years, you can continue to run, but you're just going to wear out that much faster. I am a type of person as well. I don't want to wear out like that. I want to be age appropriate. And so for me, my goal really out of this surgery was, if I could get back out and just walk, because I like to walk.
Did we achieve that goal?
Yeah, I'm at 3 miles. I used to go 4 miles, but I'm okay. My head's in the right spot. So now I just work on, can I go faster? And, you know, I can walk 16-minute mile, and that's great for me.
Excellent.
And depends on if I have my dogs with. But
so I was able to achieve our goals because your expectations were realistic.
I would say absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Now, I want to as well turn around and show what the other problems are, which are, we talked about that. In your situation, is age appropriate or age expected? You have another problem of the disc down here. And you have what we call a facet disease up here. You have osteophytic changes up here. You have sacroiliation, which is mild to moderate. And but you know, this is just how our body is. You know, it's never perfect. As soon as you know, we hit 12 years old, it goes down the hill.
And I'm not telling my brothers about that sacroiliac issue because they both have hip replacements.
Yeah, okay.
And so they're like, how do you know you don't need hip replacements next? And I said, because nobody's told me my hips are bad or anything. So
but
we're full of osteoarthritis.
And the family?
And our whole family is, my brothers and my younger brother as well. We just are full of arthritis, worse than my mother or my father were, and I don't know why.
No, it's a genetic thing. You know, the disc or our joint is like a tire of a car. There are three reasons for a tire of a car to go bad. Genetic, what factor? Is it Michelin or is it a no-name tire? Even a good tire, you put it on the road long enough, aging process, it'll go bad. But as well, how you drive it. If you go off-road, it's going to wear faster, and so on. So two of them, you have no influence, which is an aging process and the genetic. The only thing you have influence on is how you use it. And our body has a positive side. By if you put stress on our body minimally, it grows up to the occasion, and it raises up and becomes stronger. If you go too many steps too fast, you are just going to break it. And so, but at the end of the day, the idea is, you know, being able to bring a balance to the repair and the wear and tear. Your body always repairing it, and you have wear and tear. And I think you have a good common sense. And by, you know, I applaud you that you gave up those extra gardens because you understand your limits.
Yeah.
Not understanding one's limit is the best way to meet me, and then I can help you with the surgery.
Yeah, I like you a lot, and I think you're very talented, but I really don't want to meet you in a hospital or with another injection.
Well,
if I have to. But.
Well, so I'm hoping this is, though, I think we are fine. This is the best we can achieve, and we literally, statistically, based on data, we put you on a better path than if you never had this problem before. Because by bringing physical therapy, those exercises, those expectations to the equation, you will get more mileage out of this body than you would have if you never had this problem. This is the statistic. But so in that sense, I hope I never see you again.
Me too. And if people think they don't need to do their therapy because they did their therapy and they were discharged, I can tell you, if I have a busy day, and I tend to, I'm on a 90-day streak where I've done 90 days in a row, and you're right, it's addictive.
Yeah.
But before that, I found that if I even did not do those exercises 2 days in a row, I would get out of bed, and the first thing I would start with is like, oh, my back is kind of stiff this morning and sore, and it normally isn't, besides just routine, and so it's like right back. Got to get those exercises done, and I feel great.
Well, thank you so much for the interview. That has been very educational. Thank you.